lunch today. Laura Farris is the new Conservative MP for Newbury, elected at the end of last year. Welcome to the programme, Laura.
Hello.
And Duncan Enright's been here many times before. Sorry, Duncan. Leader of the Labour Group on West Oxfordshire District Council, as well as the Mayor of Witney. So what a week in politics. We thought it had gone all dull, didn't we? Are you happy to sit the way things turned out? You can't be, really, to have lost the Chancellor who fought the election.
I knew the Chancellor a bit. I thought he did a really great job as Chancellor, but I think it was quite well forecast that there could be some fairly substantial changes. I don't think Number 10 went in necessarily expecting to lose the Chancellor. There was, I think it's clear, you know, some tension between what was being requested and what how the former Chancellor saw Number 11 being operated. But Rishi Sunak was Chief Secretary to the Treasury before the promotion, so he was already, you know, in a really...
Waiting in the wings for a situation that might have seemed a little bit engineered. Does it show Boris Johnson, you're shaking your head? Just the way it worked out?
I think politics at that level is far too unpredictable to say he was waiting in the wings. He has an outstanding CV, and I think he has an amazing sort of background and talent that will allow him to be an outstanding Chancellor. But I don't think he was there sort of as some sort of, maverick type character waiting for his opportunity.
No, I'm not saying that. I'm just saying, I'm interested. Do you think that this was actually just one of those things that happened rather than planned, which gets tremendously overanalyzed by us on Sunday program?
And I think there's been a sort of tendency to kind of fixate on Dominic Cummings to make him the big sort of dramatic persona in Number 10 and to treat him as some sort of anti-hero. But I think the reality is that all prime ministers have a top team of advisors who are not elected, who are very close to them and who will be part of the prime ministerial brain and they'll work together.
Duncan's not convinced.
Arrogance of power though, isn't it? I think it's already? Boris Johnson. Well, he has a very high opinion of himself and has done all his life, I think. And now the he's had the opportunity, I think, to mould the government that he wants to see, and it's going to be lots of little Borises all down the benches, I think.
I think that's unfair, and I think that the reality is, had Jeremy Corbyn won the election, the Seamus Milnes and the Jenny Formbys, who are controversial characters within the Labour Party, would have been at the top table too. And that would
We'd have had a field day as well.
Yeah, it matters more what they do.
It's to try and make up some of the money they've lost in government cuts. Do you think it's sustainable?
The government...
The investment, the commercialisation idea that councils are investing in these things just to get the rent back.
Well, I do think that councils have an obligation to get the best return they can on public money.
They're borrowing in order to make the investment. They're only doing it to get the revenue in, to make a profit.
Yeah, I mean, I think one of the strains that I see in West Berkshire on the public purse, on the local government spending, has been on the amount that's spent on adult and children's social care. That's definitely the predominant part. The thing that will really kind of revitalise and actually transform our own budgets will be when central government comes up with the sort of strategy on social care. I think it'd be right to say that my local council are really awaiting that.
All councils are, yes. Yeah. We really wish you'd crack on with that.
Yeah.
How far away is it, didn't it?
I think it's pretty close. I mean, the Prime Minister mentions it, you know, when he's in the chamber. Mm. It's something that this government's on the front foot of. This is going to be a big reforming government, and I don't think this is a Prime Minister
if the Chancellor lets him, whoever the Chancellor is by the time we get to the budget.
Who is it today?
Is that a low blow? Anyway, so we'll notice the radical improvement in bus services.
Well, I think there are three things that have been kind of on his radar. The first is that buses are a really important way of dealing with social isolation, and the first super bus pilot is running in Cornwall, which is a county that particularly has that problem because it has spread out small communities and quite a lot of retirees. Secondly, the desire to get people out of their cars and onto public transport, and a green bus is a very efficient way of doing that. And then I think sort of thirdly, a desire that people should sort of use buses in a different way, and I've encountered in Parliament quite a lot of creative thinking, like the super buses, like different ways of having sort of timetables and sort of running operation services so that people
aren't,
you know, the old days of standing in the rain at the bus stop for 20 minutes and waiting for the bus gives way to a much more modern kind of you know, creative network.
Some of this is for cycling and walking. That's pretty important in Oxford, isn't it?
Very, yeah.
Well, I think it's right to say that the Conservatives have were probably promising the most modestly in their manifesto, and that is still a huge ambition, 30 yeah. million trees a year. That's 30,000 hectares of land yeah. for tree planting. I think it's quite easy for the political parties to get into an arms race where each one promises more, but this is a bold ambition, and I'm absolutely confident that the Conservatives are going to, they're going to realise it, or they're going to give it their absolute best shot before the next election.
Who's going to get paid to do this then? That's the point, isn't it? And compensation if you take away agricultural land. And
but even if you look at the new Environment Bill, which is about to begin its pathway through Parliament, there are very strong statutory obligations in relation to biodiversity, and that includes planting, rewilding, which has become the sort of buzzword. The whole focus and imperative on biodiversity is something that this government is taking very seriously, and that legislation is, you know, that is beginning its path. So for climate change doesn't lie within the perimeters of the United Kingdom. I mean, we are, you know, what I think I'm sort of almost proudest of actually about this country is the fact that we've taken such responsibility. We're the only one of the G7 countries to commit to reaching net zero by 2050. And I still don't think people realise how ambitious a target that is. So we're world leaders, but yes, it's correct that without China, without America contributing as much as they can, then we're only going to dent, not radically address the climate crisis that we face. Coronavirus has been raised from low to moderate, but I do think there is a very kind of sophisticated plan in place. First of all, the quarantine exercises in the Wirral for 14 days have been effective. I think they were hard for those who were quarantined, but they were successful. Secondly, the government's investing, I think, 20 million into the vaccine, which is in the process of, you know, trying to be arrived at and developed. And then thirdly, there is a new, the health secretary has announced this week a capital fund. Hospitals have to do things like section off parts of their premises for this. Yeah. The money will be available for that. So the idea of hysteria or harassment is disproportionate.
We've got to keep some sort of lid on the fear about it, haven't we?
We do, but I think...